Now we have the second lecture of Sabrina Maniscalco. Soon I will give the paper sheet so you can, we will have airplanes again today.
Yeah, of course. It's impossible otherwise. Okay, so welcome back to the second lecture on Open Quantum Systems. Today we will sort of prepare the ground to start discussing Markovian versus non-Markovian dynamics. Maybe we will begin at the very end of the lectures, although we will introduce some specific examples which are already clearly identifying the main concepts and ideas related to non-Markovianity. And I want to begin by reminding you the take-home messages of the previous lecture. The first take-home message is, remember, we always assume when we deal with master equations, and in the majority of open quantum system scenarios, factorize the initial conditions between system and environment. At the initial time, we assume that there are no correlations. This is a crucial assumption. We always do it. Even the concept itself of a dynamical map as a family of completely positive and trace-preserving operators is really relying on this assumption, or connected to this assumption. And the second take-home message is the take-home message related to the Lindblad form, Gorini, Kosakowski, Sudarshan, Lindblad form. And we notice that this describes the structure, operatorial structure, of the equation of motion of all Markovian master equations. Markovian in the sense of semigroup, as we discussed last time. But we will see this more in detail today when we give the main steps of a microscopic derivation, showing all the assumptions, or just listing all the assumptions that are behind the Markovian master equation, the form of the Markovian master equation. So this means that this solves the problem of the equation of motion for an open system for a specific class, not in general, but for a specific class of open system dynamics. Okay? So this means that, again, what I really want you to remember is that this means that if I had an equation of motion of this form, the solution is always physical. Whenever I have the Lindblad form, the solution is always representing a physical time evolution because the corresponding dynamical map is completely positive and trace-preserving. Physical always means CPTP for the dynamical map, okay? Which is a requirement whenever I have this uncorrelated initial conditions, as we discussed yesterday. Now, before we begin, I want to discuss a little bit your airplane answers. If you remember, we did yesterday a little bit this experiment of sending airplanes with an answer to the question I had. And it was actually quite interesting. We had 15 answers that were... I should remind the question, obviously. So the question I asked was, what are open quantum systems useful for? So what is the, when do we need to use open quantum systems? Actually, I think the correct question was really, when do we need to use open quantum system description or open quantum system approach? This was the original question. And 15 of you replied by saying a specific physical context or a specific task, for example, quantum computation, quantum error correction, a specific reason why we actually do need to have an incorporated description of decoherence, because we do need it in order to describe effectively certain, I don't know, quantum computation protocols in presence of noise or and so on and so forth. So there were a part of you went in this direction or in the direction of the specific physical platforms that could be quantum dots. If I'm an experimentalist, I'm working with quantum dots, I have to describe noise, so I need to use open quantum system formulas, which is, of course, definitely correct. Then there were, I think, yes, 18 of you, they were answering more along the lines of, well, I need open quantum system descriptions whenever I have an interaction between system and environment. And this is true, obviously. There are some points that I will clarify, however, that were interesting, okay? Because I think that some of the answers were, I would say yes and no. You know, there is something else to say in this regard. And then there were eight which contained either empty airplanes. We like it, keep, if you don't know what to say, just send the empty airplane. But it's better if you write something. There was several, I don't know, that's perfectly fine. And one, 42, okay. The answer is 42, of course. The answer is always 42. You can never go wrong in this game. Now, what do I want to point out here? The first thing is that for some, one of the answers, for example, was we can use open quantum system theory whenever we can decompose a system into different subsystems and ignore a fraction of them. Okay. In particular, you would say this in the simplest case with system and environment. Okay, this is just one decomposition in a bipartite case, and you ignore the environment. As a matter of fact, I mean, ignore probably is not the best word here, because it's true that we trace out the degrees of freedom of the environment, right? We do a partial trace of the degrees of freedom of the environment, but actually, and it's also true that we do not follow the dynamics of the environmental degrees of freedom. So we don't want to see what the state of the environment does or how it evolves. But it's also true that the effects of the environment are contained into the reduced open system dynamics. Okay? So the effects of the interaction with the environment, we are not really neglecting them. They are part of the present in the master equation description. So it's not like ignoring the environments in the sense that it's as if it does not exist, but its effects are incorporated in the description of the open quantum system. Is it ignoring it in the sense that we are not following the degrees of freedom of the environment? Because by definition is what we are not interested in, the system, as opposed to the system. Then there was another answer that was also interesting that says whenever we are interested in a small part of a bigger system. And this is goes together with some of you who said that the environment has to be generally much bigger than the system. And this is very often the case, actually, very often. For example, in quantum thermodynamics, many of you cited quantum thermodynamics as an example. And in quantum thermodynamics, generally, you have this thermal bath, so you have a temperature T, and then the environment is in a thermal state, and generally it is much bigger than the system. This is true. So there is very often, we generally even assume that it has infinitely many degrees of freedom in order to have truly irreversible dynamics. If the environmental degrees of freedom are finite, if I have a finite environment, generally, I would have some recurrence times, so there will be a finite Poincaré time, so the system will not necessarily, will not go to a steady state, for example, which is thermal. There will be some recurrences due to the finite size of the environment. But here, what I want to point out is that also in this case, actually, we can use open system descriptions and open system dynamics, master equations, and so on. So there are examples in which, even with finite environments, we can use open quantum system tools. Okay? So it does not. It's true that in general, environment is much bigger than the system, but there are cases in which actually we do have finite size environments, and we can use master equations, we can use dynamical maps, and so on and so forth. Then these things keeps going in the other direction. Okay. And then there was another answer related to the quantum measurement problem, the collapse of the wave function. However, the person who wrote the answer said, but this is only in theory. We cannot do it in the lab. This is another yes and no. There are some aspects somehow of the quantum measurement problems that we can probe in the lab. Of course, it's an open problem, so I mean, there is not even an open answer theoretically, but okay, there are some parts of it which can be tested in laboratory. For example, I was showing this experiment, of course, in a small system, but the key idea of the coherence of the Schrödinger cat is a little attempt to answer to this quantum measurement problem in practice, I mean, in experimental scenarios. And then there are There was another super important point I want to make here. Some of you said that whenever there is weak interaction between system and environment. So again, here some of you said that we can use Open Quantum System tools in case of weak system environment interaction, and this is actually not true, because we have, and I will show examples in which actually we can use Open Quantum System dynamics in strongly interacting systems as well. We have to be a little bit cautious with the idea, we have to be in systems or in scenarios in which actually the factorized initial conditions hold, okay? And in some cases this is not always consistent with strong interaction between system and environment. But you do not need necessarily weak interaction to use Open Quantum System tools. Then there were some enthusiastically everywhere, we can use it everywhere. And it's true, actually, it is very universal, very general, it applies to several physical contexts. But it is also true that you do not need to use it always. Okay? Now, while it is true that every quantum system is never completely isolated, okay? There is always some interaction with some environment, the vacuum of the electromagnetic field, whatever. I mean, ultimately there is always something that quantum systems interact with. But there exist examples of experimental situations or experimental scenarios that require a very complicated setup, that requires a lot of, but they are able to isolate quantum systems so well that within the experimental time, actually, environmental noise is negligible. Negligible in the sense that you don't really even see it in the experiment. So there exist experimental settings where the system is so well isolated that the description in terms of a closed system is, again, it's always an approximation, but it holds for all practical purposes in the experiment. So this is also another thing we should remember. And then, let's see if I had one more comment on your questions. Yes, and this is actually related to what I said before. In the case of many-body systems, the case of many-body system is interesting because actually a number of experiments with ultra-cold gases, for example, Bose lattices and ultra-cold gases with optical lattices, are actually very, very well described as closed systems. I mean, not often you need noise there. I mean, there is really a very good matching between experimental results and theoretical predictions without, the need of considering noise. In some cases you need, in others you don't. This just means that the conditions created by the experimentalists are of such a good isolation that actually you can obtain these results without using open systems approaches. They are cases, in general you would need. I think this is everything I wanted to say after looking and thinking about what you wrote, and I, as you know now, we will again do the airplane questions during this lecture, this time in a different framework and different settings. Okay, let's begin now. A small recap of what we said in the previous lecture. We introduced the dynamical map, which is a family of completely positive and trace-preserving linear maps with this initial condition. This is identity, n is the dimension of the Hilbert space of the quantum system, of the open system. And then we notice that the dynamical map is connected to the generator of the dynamics, which is actually what describes the operatorial form of the master equation through this relation. And we also say that when actually the generator or the right-hand side of the master equation is not explicitly time-dependent, then we have a semigroup for the dynamical map. So the dynamical map satisfies the semigroup property. And in this case, we have this very, very well-known theorem, Gorini-Kosakowski-Sudarshan theorem. And we also notice that this is the form of the Gorini-Kosakowski-Sudarshan Lindblad. master equation is this form. You see, when I say that it's not explicitly time dependent, you don't have any time. Of course, rho is time dependent, obviously, here on the right and left hand side. But none of these other operators have explicit time dependence here, and also not the decay rate. There is nothing which has a time dependency. So this is the case in which L is not time dependent. Okay, the superoperator is not time dependent. Now, in order to understand why this is an approximation, in this sense, this Busser equation is not general, but is an approximation, we will give some really main points, main steps of what is known as the microscopic approach. What do I mean with this? So what I mean is that we will begin considering a total closed system, so system plus bath. Here the density operator of system plus bath is called rho sp, so it's a total closed system. Before I called it rho t, here it's rho sp, sorry for changing notation, but it's just the total density operator. And because the total closed system is obviously closed, then we can describe the dynamics of the total system with the von Neumann equation. So we don't need to have any dissipation because by definition the system is closed. And generally we start with the von Neumann equation in the interaction picture. Okay, this is always the starting point of the microscopic derivations for reasons that are basically clear as we proceed. But one of the main reasons is exactly that we have in mind that we will be working in weak coupling. So we are performing actually an expansion in the coupling constant in order different orders of coupling constant, and therefore the interaction part is what counts most when you do the interaction picture. And in the interaction picture, interaction Hamiltonian is time dependent. Now, what I want to do is I will not do the microscopic derivation here. I will show you the steps, just some of the steps and the main approximations, just because we don't have enough time, but to recall actually what we are actually doing in order to derive an equation of motion for the open system from a total microscopic description of system and bath. Okay? Yes?
Can you describe in a little bit more detailed way how to consider as a closed system, but with time-dependent Hamiltonian, where the time dependence comes from?
Yeah, with time-dependent Hamiltonian, you can also do the microscopic derivation. So what is important here is that, so you can also have the Lindblad form. So the presence of time-dependent time dependency in the Hamiltonian of the system, it is not a problem in general, okay? What becomes a problem in the sense of the derivation of a Lindblad form, okay? You can be incorporated without problems. What becomes problematic is, for example, if you have time dependency in the interaction couplings between system and environment, or in the environment Hamiltonian. And also you will see that actually the time-dependent coefficients in the or a time-dependent Liouvillean also arises when I look at, when I don't do some of the approximations that I do in the microscopic derivation. But the fact that the Hamiltonian of the system is actually time-dependent, it's okay in the whole derivation that we will do here. You can assume it. It does not create problems. You have to be a bit careful with time scales, because the whole microscopic derivation relies on a number of on clear differences in the time scales, for example, of evolution of the system with respect to evolution of the environment, or the correlations between system and environment, and so on and so forth. So the only thing I could say is that when you have a time-dependent system Hamiltonian, the only thing I would be careful is that when you do the rotating wave approximation, so the secular approximation, the time scale there become important. Okay, so as I said, just main steps for now. What you do here is that you start from these, you write the integral form, okay? You solve formally this differential equation, you write it in integral form, and then you plug in this solution, this integral solution, back here. Okay, you can do it as many times as you want. In this way, you have a series eventually of different terms. So the first term will have a commutator between the interaction Hamiltonian and the system at time zero, and the second term will have a double commutator inside the integral. Okay, so this is the first step, and it's here. Okay. Here I only have the double commutator because I'm assuming that actually the first term goes to zero. Okay, it's not a strict assumption, okay, the fact that this commutator goes to zero. It simply means, it, for example, it happens when you have an environment in a thermal state, so it's all diagonal, and your system, the interaction with the environment, so let's make a specific, so say the interaction Hamiltonian, for example, is of the type, could be operator of the system, operator of the environment, and this operator of the environment, for example, is like the quantized electromagnetic field. I have some over k, certain coefficient gk, b dagger k. It's the amplitude really plus g star k, dk. And if you have generally, if you have this form and you have a thermal initial state, this just happens. It's simply because you can calculate it easily. It's just the average. When you calculate like an expectation value of the environmental field in a thermal state, it gives you zero, because the thermal state is diagonal, and here you have B and B daggers. And this basically leads to zero in the commutator, in the trace of the path of the commutator. That's the idea behind. Okay, so this term generally is set to zero, but it's not crucial. You can keep it if you want. Then what you do is that you do another approximation, okay? So you have the total state at time s, where s is the variable of integration, okay? And what you assume, I call it, this is part of the Markovian or weak coupling approximation. You do two things. The first thing you do is that you say, actually, this state is approximately still factorized. So you keep an approximately factorization of the system bath state. Okay, these are strong assumptions, but they are actually what you do when you do the Markovian approximation. You assume approximately uncorrelated states for a time that is inside this integral at the moment, because of course this is an integral between zero and t, and this state is between zero and t. And then the second thing, so in this way, when you do this assumption, you will have, you see, in this case, you already have a closed integral differential equation for the system only. Okay, where is rho s? For rho s, okay? So before you didn't, because before you couldn't write rho s of s here. You had the total system, but now you can, okay? So this is now an integral differential equation for the state of the system. You have to do this, you have to make this assumption. And now you do the second part of the Markov approximation. So at this stage, the future depends on the past, okay? As we said yesterday, this is an integral differential equation. The derivative of the state depends on all the history of the state between zero and t at this stage. Here we are still integral differential. The next thing you do, which is actually the second part of the Markovian approximation, is that you actually say, well, this rho s of s is approximately the same as rho s of t. The state has not been changing much between s and t. And actually here, you will end when you do this with the so-called Redfield equation. Okay, the spirit here is that actually you have, you can do this because correlation times are short and therefore, as I said, I'm just listing the steps. I'm not doing the exact derivation. I just want to tell you what you do step by step. And you need to go hands-on and do the calculations to do this. And actually, I would recommend, it's easy to do it if you do it on a specific example. For example, a two-level atom interacting with a quantized bath. Then you do all the derivation of the Maxwell equation in the zero temperature, and you understand what this means. But here I'm just listing them. And the reason why I'm listing them is that they are strong assumptions, okay? All of them. It may seem that they are not often verified, but they are. So here I have a Redfield equation. Now this is time local. So the derivative here, so the future, depends only on the state at time t. There is a lot of other stuff inside this integral, but the state of the system is at time t. Okay, it's not. So this is a time local Maxwell equation. This is it's known as the Redfield equation. Then you do another approximation that you see here. I still have integral between zero and t. But actually, it turns out it's the same if I extend this integral between zero and infinity. So if I send the t to infinity, I'm neglecting completely, I'm really coarse-graining in time. I'm neglecting completely any correlation between system and bath. I have integral between zero and infinity here, and I have a form which is now well. I mean, we will see. We can't say yet anything because we would need to explicitly write down the form of the interaction Hamiltonian to see how it looks like. But this is the second part of the Markovian assumption. And I don't know why there is this tau s and tau r, but here it is everything. So the fifth assumption is actually that we do the secular approximation. So the fourth one is again Markovian, second part, and secular approximation or also rotating wave approximation is the approximation that tells that if the time scale of the system is much smaller, the relaxation time of the system, meaning the time at which the system relaxes to the stationary state, should be much smaller, much greater. Ah, I think this is the other way around. The relaxation time has to be greater than the typical time of the system. I think it's the other way around, sorry. The system is the evolution is faster than the relaxation time. Okay, let me think.
It's so written time, system in both cases, so it's not the other way around.
It should be faster. I think it's the other way around. The relaxation should be faster than the typical time scale of the system, which is the opposite of what I'm writing here, right? Because I'm writing the typical time scale of the system is faster than the relaxation time. Sorry, I will modify the slides and get back to you. Yes, the relaxation should be... No, it's right. The relaxation should be slower than the typical time scale of the system, which is exactly what you have. So, let's say that you are in a situation. This is relaxation, not correlation time. This is the relaxation means, this means basically, for example, if you have damped Rabi oscillations, the state of the time evolution of the system is the period of the Rabi oscillations, and you would have, let's say, something which goes like this, and the relaxation. So the relaxation time is longer than the typical time scale of the system. So the typical scale of the system is, oh my God. I hate it. So relaxation time should last. So the relaxation should last a lot more than the typical time scale in this case. Yes, exactly. Exactly. The relaxation should last longer than the typical time scale of the system. Okay. So it's something that I will always... It's not the first time. Every time I arrive here, I call it the same thing. Okay. Now, in this, if you do all these approximations, and again, I'm just listing them. I'm not doing here the, of course, the microscopic derivation. You will obtain a Lindblad form that is what we define or describe below. So the Lindblad form comes at the end of all these steps. And if your system does not satisfy these properties, then you need to do or describe the dynamics with something which is more general. Yes, question.
So in the model, we assume that at all time, the system and the bath are in a product state. It's the one of the approximation we make. But then there is something that confuses me. I don't see how the system density matrix could evolve physically if in the model we say they are in product state at all time, because they interact, but they don't interact. So I'm confused.
This is a very important point. I mean, this does not mean, and this is something which created me a lot of issues. Your same question, the same problem that you are saying. So this does not mean that we can say that there is no entanglement between system and environment, okay? What this means is that I'm doing a serious approximation, okay? A serious expansion. And at some point, I'm assuming that approximately there is this this relation. But it does not mean that there is no entanglement between system and environment. I don't know if it's clear, this. I mean, probably the best thing to see it is really to figure out some specific examples, and we will do one. Okay, we will look at one specific example because this is it remains too general unless I specify system and environment and so on and so forth. So actually, even for Markovian dynamics, there can be entanglement between system and environment, but approximately, you can use this write this factorized form in order to derive the master equation. However, this does not mean that system and environment are not entangled, actually. Again, we will do an example in which we will, it's called the two-level atom interacting with the vacuum, it's called the Janis-Cummings model, which we will solve exactly. And then we will make the limits, the Markovian limit and the completely strong coupling limit. And then we will see what it means. But it's something that has been bothering me, actually, because my and only now I start to have a better understanding of all these things. Because, yes, I mean, it's annoying to think, you know, really. I mean, am I really considering that they are uncorrelated? Then how can I have effects? How can people ever talk about entanglement as inducing decoherence in open quantum systems? I mean, for all the Markovian system. When I have the experiment, for example, of Serge Haroche of the Schrödinger cat states that I showed before, I mean, it's a Markovian dynamics. It's described very well by a Markovian master equation. So does it mean that decoherence, the death of the Schrödinger cat and so on, occurs in absence of entanglement with the environment? So it has been bothering me for a long time. But I think the specific example, so it's a very good point. The specific example will clarify it. Yeah. But this is what we need to do when we do the microscopic derivation. It's part of the microscopic derivation. By the way, one of the references, the book that I was citing, that is the Breuer and Petruccioni, this is taken really mostly step by step by the Breuer and Petruccioni theory of open quantum system book. It's the same, so I'm highlighting the steps of the microscopic derivation from the book. So in case you want to know the details, in the books they are discussed. Now, take-home message, Markovian master equations are approximations. So this is something please remember, okay? Now, do you remember the other two take-home messages? Okay, no, because you really have, I really want that when you leave these lectures for at least a week, you should remember them. Okay, what were the other two approximations? Fast, fast, loud, loud, come on, don't be ashamed. Yes, yeah, the Lindblad equation is the most general form of semi-group dynamics, which is physical. And the other one? Huh? Ah, yes, no, the serious one. Factorize initial conditions, exactly. At the initial time, you have factorized initial conditions. Correct, okay. Do remember this, okay? One of my main tasks. Now, how do we do to describe systems beyond these assumptions, beyond the Markovianity?